Rekind. Rewind.
This is Dope Nostalgia.
Welcome to an all-new episode of Dope Nostalgia. I'm your host, Naomi. And today, we are featuring somebody who I talked to all the way in Europe, Daisy D. She's one of the members and one of the founding members of the super techno house electronic dance music group, Technotronic. Big, big hits include Pump Up the Jam, Move This, and so many more. So, hey, check it out. But before we do that, we're going to go to some news for you.
Hot off the presses, you gotta adjust those rabbit ears. You got that antenna pulled up? It's time for some dope nostalgia news.
Canadian dance group Prozac, half of that band is James Bryan. And James Bryan is coming out with a brand new single on May 29th with his duo with AJ Harvey. The single will be called If I Ain't Got You. And you can check out more of that on his Instagram, James Bryan Music. That's JamesBryan Music. Episode 25 guests, Right Said Fred, have joined up with NFT Bulldog at nftbulldog.com. Now, what exactly is that? They are the UK's premium non-fungible token marketing platform that bridges the gap between music, art, and technology while allowing artists to create revenue without interference. So Right Said Fred have a brand new collection available right there, their very first ones. This will start being available already May 15th, so check that out. Now, do any of you remember the group The Party? They were derived from the 90s version of the Mickey Mouse Club. The members Tiffany, Dee Dee, Chasen, Damon, and Albert. Yes, I remember them all. No longer is Tiffany in the group, but there is a reunion happening with The Party at the House of Blues Orlando, just announced for September 11th. If you're in the Orlando area, you might want to go and see what they're all about.
Wikipedia moment.
Technotronic was a Belgian electronic music project formed in 1988 by Joe Bogaert, who originally gained popularity in Europe as a solo artist with various new beat projects, including the acts of Mad Men and Nux Nemo. Together with rapper Manuela Camozzi, aka Ya Kid K, he produced the single Pump Up the Jam, which was originally an instrumental released under the name The Pro 24s. With Bogaert adopting the name Thomas De Quincey, a front for the act was put together in a way similar to other Eurodance and Europop products like Blackbox or Milli Vanilli, utilizing Congolese-born fashion model Feli Kalingi, who became the group's rapper, appearing on the single's cover art and in the music video. The song became a worldwide success, eventually reaching number 2 on both the US Hot 100 and the UK Singles Chart in late 1989 and early 1990. It became the first house song to reach the top 10 of the US Hot 100 chart. It was also one of the first songs outside Chicago to pioneer the hip house genre, a fusion of house music with elements of hip hop. Also in 1989, Ya Kid K contributed vocals to the single Spin That Wheel, produced by Bogaert under another pseudonym called High Tech 3, with Ya Kid K fully credited as guest rapper. This original version was released by the Brothers organization in conjunction with Telstar Records UK in early 1990 and would reach number 69 on the UK charts. The success of the project's first single led to the release of Pump Up the Jam, the album, which featured tracks by Ya Kid K and MC Eric. During 1990, the album would climb into the top 10 of the Billboard 200 in the US and reach number 2 on the UK Albums Chart. They also became an opening act for Madonna and had appearances on Saturday Night Live, The Arsenio Hall Show, and its Showtime at the Apollo. It was at this time that Ya Kid K became credited in Technotronic's singles as she was actually featured vocalist, though Feli still lip-synced the backing vocals in the video for Get Up Before the Night is Over, a follow-up single which was a number 7 hit in the US. The third UK Top 40 was This Beat is Technotronic, and featuring MC Eric instead of Ya Kid K, though she was again the featured vocalist on the fourth UK hit, Rockin' Over the Beat. The song also reached the top 10 in many countries. By 1991, Ya Kid K had left Technotronic to pursue a solo career, releasing the single Awesome, You Are My Hero, from the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2 soundtrack in 1991, followed in 1992 by the solo album One World Nation. Neither was commercially successful. In 1992, the song Move This from the Pump Up the Jam, the album, featuring vocals by Yeah Kid K, became popular through its use in a Revlon television commercial and became the group's third top 10 hit in the United States. Our amazing guest today, Daisy D, is one of the original singers for Technotronic. She's featured on the song This Beat Is Technotronic, Do It Better, Back It Up, Yeah Yeah, Dance, Love Religion. She's done so many tunes with them and is such a huge star in her own right over in Europe. She's a Dutch singer, actress, TV host, stylist, and television producer. She's well known in German-speaking media, and Daisy D hosted the German television show Club Rotation on Viva MTV until 2003, and she's here with us today. Welcome, Daisy D, to the show.
I'm just really grateful for your time and that you agreed to be on the show, so thank you.
Yes, I'm so honored. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. I have a series of questions about what you're up to now, as well as what happened with the Technotronic days and what's going on with that today. So I feel like Technotronic were an act that took house and techno out of the club scene and kind of put it into the mainstream charts at that time. How did you get involved with them?
Well, it was no Technotronic before we just started, you know. My brother started in the music industry. That's how I actually got really deeper in it. Mm-hmm. It started all as a joke. So Joe Bogart, a Technotronic producer, he was just making beats, and you know, that was just a coincidence thing. Mm-hmm. And Manuela, Yeah Kid K, and myself, we were super young. I mean, Manuela was 14 and I was 17.
Yeah,
that was like ages ago. And he needed some voices and some cool stuff on the stuff that he was doing in the studio. And we needed a studio because we wanted to make music like N.W.A.
Nice.
Oh my God.
Nice.
We wanted to make cool hip hop music. We thought that what we were doing for him was just BS. Mm. That's how it all like kind of started. So we wrote some lyrics and was jamming in the studio, and he made from the samples of our voices, he created the first hit, Pump Up the Jam.
Wow.
And we didn't want to do the video, you know? So in the beginning, we were not even in the video. It was another, like a dummy girl. Because we were like, nah, we don't want nobody to see us doing that, you know?
That was a thing that happened a lot then.
We saw our song on MTV. We were like, what? Did you see that?
Wow.
We were like, what is this? We just didn't understand what was happening. You know? And our parents, they were like, oh, whatever. Nobody took it serious, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, the people that were inside of the music business, like Joe and, you know, and my brother was like, oh, my God. They're selling so many. Mm. It's like one of those Cinderella stories, you know?
Totally.
Yeah, totally.
There was it's an amazing story. Yeah. And there was a lot of that happening with dance music at the time, where it's like obviously the producers put the music out, like Joe, and but then in the video we weren't sure if that was the real artist or not.
Well, you know, in the 90s it was all about the look.
Yeah.
Not so much about the voice. These days it's all about, well, basically most of it is about the voice.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be able to sing live, da 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 da. You have to be able to perform, you know. Actually, these days it's more about the full package.
Mm-hmm.
Back then you just needed to look good to be able to get a gig, you know.
Yeah.
And so a lot of producers like Milli Vanilli, you know, a lot of them, like Black Box, I can like Capella, there's so many.
Mm-hmm.
That just started to make the music, and then they looked for somebody, hopefully black, that looked good to put them in, and that was it. And then when everybody was starting to get exposed, people were like, oh, maybe that's not such a good idea. And America was anyway not really down with that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So when our song became big in the States, they started to ask us. I was super serious with my fashion school. So they started to ask us, like, can you guys come over? And, you know, Yakit, my colleague from Technotronic, she kind of looked like a boy, you know?
Mm, so she had, like, an androgynous look, hey?
yeah, in the beginning, that was not that welcomed, you know, because she was very, very tomboyish.
Mm-hmm.
And I took my school very serious because of my mom, so I wasn't allowed to go on tour immediately, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then after a little while, our manager said, hey, you can make so much money with this, you know? She's got to drop out of school. And my mom was like, no, she can only go if she gets a private teacher. So here I was on tour with a private teacher. I couldn't go anywhere except studying it on stage. I did it, you know?
You did. A lot to balance at that time.
Excuse me?
That would have been a lot to balance at that time.
Yeah, there was no... I can't really tell you that it was... I mean, that it was that difficult.
Mm-hmm.
I did love going out and stuff, but I wasn't one of those wild kids.
Yeah.
I came from a very strict mom, so I kind of, like, my goal was to make her proud, you know?
Yeah.
So remembering how I was feeling when everybody else was in a club and I was going to bed because I had to study, I remember right at Technotronic or within the Technotronic career, another opportunity came for me to host a show on the German MTV called Viva, that's called Club Rotation, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that was only about club music. You can find all of this on the internet. It's all there. And I did that for like 14 years or something, you know?
Oh, cool.
And I hosted that show. That was crazy. On that show, I met everybody and their mama.
Yeah.
I met, you know? And at the end, because I was one of the producers, I gave people like David Guetta their first shot on that show. And, you know, like that, most of us became friends. I met Mariah Carey on that show. I met Whitney Houston on that show. There was like a lot of, like, huge celebrities that are still there,
mm-hmm.
that I've met. Because of that show, you know, because they wanted to break through with, let's say, sometimes the pop music didn't work out, so they wanted to, in the 90s, they wanted to break through with dance. Some of the producers and some of the record companies called me personally, even offered me money to be on my show. I was like, what?
That's incredible. So you had a lot of influence, obviously, especially with helping break people in the European market.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. So many.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for the German, that time, the German market, I mean, that show lasted, I think it was from 89 until 2000 and, I don't know, a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And that show was the most important show for dance music on the German television, aka Europe, the biggest. We sold compilations, you know, like with my face on it, Club Rotation compilation.
Mm-hmm.
We sold weekly 4 million, bam, 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 for years. That was a huge, huge success. Sometimes I forget, you know, that I did so many things. And I'm like, fuck. You know, I did so many things. Like, yeah, like now that we have the pandemic and kind of like the music is not, it's no priority in life anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of like forgot about it. You know, like I'm thinking sometimes when I'm by myself, I'm thinking like, okay, so what would be next for me in my life? What is like the biggest next thing that I would like to do?
Mm-hmm.
That I didn't do yet, you know? And the only thing that comes in my head, it's teaching, or better yet, what I'm doing with my son, you know? I have an 18-year-old son, and he has his whole life in front of him, and he doesn't really want to ask mom what to do.
Right.
You know, he kind of want to find his own way.
Yeah.
And while I'm behind the scenes helping him, I'm seeing all of these possibilities. Like, I'm like, yo, I can teach people how to do music, how to do styling, how to reinvent themselves, how to help themselves, how to help their family, how to, there's so much knowledge in all that I've done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, And I think the best thing to do with all that knowledge, instead of pushing it in the kid that's like, I'm too cool for your stuff. there's so many people out there that need advice, that wants to, like, that don't know what to do, you know? And I know exactly what to do.
Exactly. Teaching is a wonderful idea.
I love it. I mean, that's something I don't even know if we can do it for a long time, because our bookings are starting to come for September.
Oh, good.
So I don't know if I can commit myself on something like that. But just teaching people about lifestyle, about music, about fashion.
Mm-hmm.
It's so many things that could be done. Yeah. That was just peace of my mind. Yeah, I'm sorry. You go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm glad you shared that. And that's something, once you start doing teaching, I'd love to share that on our podcast and let everybody know about what you're doing with that, too.
Yeah, that's something. It came up in my head yesterday. Yesterday, mm-hmm. I was cooking, taking care of the family, cleaning, just taking care. And I'm like, and my son is now, he wants to become a fashion stylist.
Yeah.
Know? So I'm online and I'm helping him out, looking for different, and I'm like, yo, if you were open for it, you don't need no education, he's got me.
That's right.
I can give him jobs. I know exactly, I know everybody. You know, come on, let's go. That's funny. Introducing the band to make you understand how this is planned. Our DJ, the microphone to rock the homeboys with an instrumental to make noise. I'll explain the name of the crew. Yo, this beat is Technotronic. This beat is Technotronic. And Eric, got Eric for ya. I saw your posse, but now it's me who's boss. So I'm giving the orders around here. You don't wanna get sick, no fear. Good buddy, go and get the phone ready. Aim yourself ready. Look steady. Like a rock and I won't stop. Then I set to stop. And the suckers drop the up to it. Yo, you couldn't do it. To get more to the points and do it. But not like the boys speak up. They can't go on because of weaker. I speak a strong posse. I answer all just the posse. People, that people beat can equal beats that I produce. And techno produced it. So type right, you can't be a loose fit. So step right up, boy, your sizes. You know what the first prize is. This beat is Technotronic. This beat is Technotronic. And Eric, got Eric for ya.
And that reminds me, your production company, Booyah Music, in your Wikipedia, it states that you worked with artists like Backstreet Boys and NSYNC at that time as well.
Yeah, so, definitely, yeah.
So is that all related to the TV show as well?
No. That was a little bit different. Booyah Music was the company of my ex-husband and myself, Tony Couture, you know?
Okay.
And Tony had or has, I mean, everything still exists. Tony has a band called Fun Factory. Have you ever heard about Fun Factory?
Yes. Sure have.
Yes, that's his. Yeah, that's his. And we met because Fun Factory and myself, we had the same manager in that time. And our manager was very close friends with Johnny, oh my God, the ex-manager from the Backstreet Boys.
Right?
Johnny Wright, yeah. Anyway, so they were very close. And in that time, I just started dating my ex-husband, and he didn't speak very good English. Mm-hmm. He spoke mostly German, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And as English is my second language, every time he wrote songs, I gave him the lyrics to the songs. So he had to make one song for the Backstreet Boys as a test.
Mm.
And he wrote, the first song was Get Down. Yeah, Get Down.
Oh, wow.
Was this my song? Yeah.
Yep.
So we wrote that together. Get Down, you know? And then Johnny loved the song, and he flew the guys over from the States to Germany to break them in Germany first. And that's what happened. So I styled them and put them all together and, you know, styled the whole photo shoot, and I just... And my ex-husband, Tony, he just took care of the music together with my brother. And I also, you know, did the whole, you know, management. We just did everything. for them. And then I remember later on, NSYNC came, you know, Justin. Mm-hmm. Justin Timberlake was, yeah, he was 14, I think 14 or 15. And, yeah, he had still that blonde hair with the curlies, you know. I cut them all off. I remember that. He was like, no!
Holy. Oh,
yeah. So all of that was done in that time like it was nothing, like water, you know?
Wow.
And, yeah, that's how we kind of, like, build up a full catalog of artists and people. And, yeah, it was just an amazing, beautiful, knowledgeable time for all of us.
That's really exciting. You've got to do so much with that company. Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know why Tony don't have Rhea no more, but when we got a divorce in that time, we had a lot of property. You know, we made a lot of money back then, a lot. So I was involved in everything. But what was the most important for me was we had a house that wasn't finished yet in Belgium. Mm-hmm. And I remember during the divorce, I told him, look, Tony, we can sell everything and split the money, or we can just split the stuff. You keep the record company, I will keep the house, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's what we did. We signed everything off. I kept the house. He had a house in Miami, and we had one house in New York. He had two houses in Hamburg. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to have this house because it was close to my family. And I'm still here. I'm living in a huge, beautiful house. I have nothing to complain.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah. I'm glad you were able to work it all out.
It wasn't ready back then, but I still had my career with, you know, Diva. This is years ago.
Yeah.
So I made also very, very good income, and I finished my beautiful home. And at the end of the day, everything actually worked out. We're still all friends. Really nice.
That's what you want to hear, you know, when people can amicably resolve things in the end, right?
In the end, in the beginning, it's war. You know how it is. Yeah, I did that, you did that, you have that, I got that, da-da-da-da-da. But then you get older, or better yet, more mature, you understand that it's, you know, when you go down the ground, you can't take all that shit with you. So it's okay. No problem.
You know it. It's true. You were also on a German soap opera. Now, how did you like acting in the soap opera?
Well, I did that for a year. Mm-hmm. That was very difficult, but it helped me to really, really fix my German.
Mm.
And, because I didn't really speak German that good in the beginning, you know, of my career. And all of a sudden, I was next to Technotronic. I had, like, a career with this club rotation and that I had to host. And then I had also the soap opera. That was crazy. It was like, honestly, that year of the soap opera was like school for teaching the language, you know?
Yeah.
And, I liked it, but it was not one of my favorite things to do. Mm-hmm. It was really tough, waking up really early in the morning, getting on my lines, being on set, full of makeup and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I have to be on point, and my head was just so full with so many different projects.
Yeah,
but it was exciting. It was nice. I took that as a real nice time in my life.
Well, and obviously it helped you so much with learning the language. How many languages do you speak now?
I speak 5 languages now. Yeah,
that's amazing. And your English is really good, like really good.
Yeah, and I'm Dutch. Can you imagine? Oh my God.
Get up on your feet before the night is through for you.
new voicemail number just for you.
Give us a call at Dope Nostalgia. Our number is 780-851-8785.
Leave us a message. Pick up the phone just like you used to in the old days. Remember before text messaging? Yeah, we used to actually call each other.
If you just want to be heard and be on the podcast, give us a call. Once again, our Dope Nostalgia hotline, 780-851-8785.
Pick up the phone.
Remember, this number is Canadian, so long-distance charges may apply.
Hey everybody, what's up? It's DJ AK The Amanda Knight from No More Games Radio. Check us out at nomoregamesradio.com and keep listening to my favorite girl, Naomi, on the most excellent 90s podcast, Dope Nostalgia.
Yo, come on, move this. Shake that body.
Revlon Outrageous Lip Color, all-out color and shine for outrageous lips.
What's one of your most memorable performances that you've done?
Honestly, we had a performance in, was it Mexico? Yeah, it was in Mexico in the Pepsi Stadium with like 200,000 people.
Is that Mexico City?
I remember... Yeah, in Mexico City.
Wow.
Like, Pepsi Stadium. Yeah, that was really recent. That was like, I think 2019 or 2018.
Mm-hmm.
You can Google it and see it. It was like, that was like crazy. Even though we went through a lot of things before,
mm-hmm.
now because it's 90s, you can see the grandmother, you can see the mother, you can see uncle, kids. Everybody singing our songs, you know,
the whole family.
That, I don't know. That's, you know, that back then it was just us. We were young, and you know, of course, we were the hottest and the best and whatever, the better looking ones. But now, you know, we have age, a little bit more weight, and then you go there on this huge stage, and what do you see? Everybody singing your songs. That's crazy. That's amazing. So we did that. We just had a tour in before the pandemic in Mexico, Venezuela, Brazil. Oh, we were everywhere.
Oh. Yeah. What's one of the favorite places you've gotten to visit while touring?
Woo! Honestly, there's a lot.
Yeah.
There's a lot. There's not many places that I really like. Go and say, oh, I'm enjoying this place so much because of every place has a special, something special.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like some places is great because like South America is amazing because the people are really open and they love you. Like really, they cry, you know, like for real. Europe is colder. The people are colder, but you have a lot of other artists that are my friends here, like To Unlimited and Captain Hollywood, you know, like we're really close,
yeah.
All of us, you know?
Yeah.
We meet up, we hang out, we talk about ourselves, we talk about back in the days, we can be honest to each other, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a really nice feeling to be in Europe for that. So we meet up, like I'm the stylist of To Unlimited, I do business with Captain Hollywood, I meet with Dr. Alban, like we just all meet up together and do stuff, you know?
Oh, that's so great.
Yeah, we're like really, really close, all of us. Yeah.
And you'll be able to tour together, hopefully when this pandemic is over?
Yeah. We toured together before, and the pandemic will not really be over. That's something that's going to take a while.
Yeah.
But we're probably going to have to adjust to it. To be able, I don't know, everybody wear a mask and then go to the concert, you know, some stupid shit like that.
Yeah.
Even though with a mask, you cannot have a drink. But anyway, we'll figure it out.
Well, we will. for sure.
Yeah, yeah, we're gonna be fine, and we can't leave it like this. It can't be like this forever. But we just now with the pandemic, everybody's like reinventing themselves, which is really nice, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's busy with something. Nobody's really sitting at home crying that there is no show. Of course, we make way more money when we do the shows, you know. But now that we don't really have them, it's like, hey, we make clothing, we do online stuff, we do whatever it takes, you know.
Absolutely, and it's a good time to be creative and to write and create more music.
Yeah, definitely. That's anyway something that we do daily: making music, creating TV shows, online shows, creating. You know, like my brother's name is Papa Bear. You know.
Yeah.
And now he's starting. He's gonna start together with Nestle. They're gonna start like an online cooking show, music and cooking, rock and roll cuisine. It's called really cool. Really cool.
Yeah, yep. He gets to try to do things that he's always thought about doing that he didn't have time for before, but now you do.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. It's wonderful. Yeah.
Now,
I kind of like the pandemic, you know? Honestly.
Yeah, it's making us think outside the box.
Absolutely. I love that.
Now, you're located in Belgium, right?
Yes, I am.
Where would you tell someone who is a tourist to come visit in Belgium? What are some of your favorite spots?
Ooh. Belgium, I love Antwerp. I don't like Brussels that much. It's a little bit dirty, but Antwerp is very fashionable if that's one of those things that you like.
Mm.
They have great restaurants, all kinds of restaurants, from African food, Jamaican food, to Italian food, to German food. Like, I like Antwerp a lot. Brugge is beautiful. I mean, Belgium is small but really nice. Mm. I love the place that I live with my family because it's very close to Holland and to Germany.
Mm.
So you kind of feel Europe more or less more when you're like in this corner, you know? I live at the Three Points.
Oh, good.
So it's like, yeah, 5 minutes you go to Holland. I do my groceries in Holland. I go, you know, put my gas in Germany because it's cheaper.
That's so cool.
I just live in Europe. I'm just everywhere. Like, you know, then it's 2 hours or 1.5 hours to Luxembourg. So my bank account is there. I go there.
That's, wow. See, I live in Canada, and Canada is so massive that it takes just to get to the U.S. for where I live, it's like 6-7 hour drive.
Oh,
that's how far away I am from a border.
Yeah, from a border, and I'm like literally living on a border. It's like I can walk to the border, you know. It's crazy.
Now, is it easy to cross borders? You just drive right through them, or do they make you stop?
Mostly they check, you know, where you come from. Like, because I'm Dutch, but I have a German company also.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm Dutch. I live in Belgium. I have a German company. I'm driving a German car, and I'm doing groceries in Holland. It's like all over the place. By now, when they stop me at the border, they all know, okay, that's Daisy. She lives there. She does that. It's all good.
Oh, that's wonderful.
I just follow the rules with the mask, with, you know, the social distancing, doing the groceries by myself. I'm not taking anything that heavy. I'm kind of like, you know, it is what it is.
Absolutely. Here, it's like, if you want to go to the U.S., it's a big, like, ordeal. Like, even before the pandemic, like, when you go to border crossings, it's a lot harder to get across.
Well, I remember being in Canada a few times, and back then I was dating a guy that was really smoking a lot of weed.
Mm-hmm.
And just because he had the smell on his toothbrush, he almost got declined to go to enter Canada. I was like, did you take weed with you? He said, no. The dogs were like, woof, 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 because he had, oh my God, he had the smell of weed on his toothbrush. I'm like, what is this? Oh my God. So I know how strong and hard it is, you know, from Canada entering or even going out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, it's sometimes I find at the border crossing, it's harder to get back into Canada than it was to get into the U.S. It's very strange.
Yeah, absolutely. I can imagine. I can totally imagine. Oh, my God. Oh, well.
When did you reunite with Technotronic and what point, and then the tour started again?
About 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 4 years ago, was it? Yeah, now it's 2021. 4 years ago, we started again. It was like Manuela Yakete was doing it by herself. I still had my career that is that was like very, 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 very busy with my career on television. So I wasn't really interested in doing Technotronic, mm-hmm. you know? And then about 5 years ago, Manuela started to complain that she doesn't want to do it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And the management already started calling me before that, like, don't you guys want to do it together and stuff? I said, yeah, sure. But it wasn't really my thing. My son was also, in my feeling, way too young for me to leave him alone with 13, 14 years old,
yeah.
you know? And I didn't really want to do that because I knew that when I would start touring, I wouldn't be home almost,
right.
you know, and my ex wouldn't, you know, he wouldn't be able to look after the, after our child, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it was like, I was like, okay, I don't really want to do that. But then she quitted the whole Technotronic thing, and they really made a great schedule for me that they knew that in the weekends I can go and during the week I would be home. And yeah, more and more my son got bigger. Now he's 18. So actually 2020, we had like 150 shows to do
mm-hmm.
all over. And then the pandemic hit and all of a sudden I am basically more at home and doing everything from home except my styling job. And my son is like, you're always home. That's so boring.
When they're at that age. Yeah.
Yeah, but now he's like, I'm like, you're going to be so happy in a couple of years that you had me like for a year all the time at home. You're going to be happy.
Yes. It takes some, they do realize that after.
After a while.
How have you taken care of your voice over the years on the road? And what do you have any special routines you do for before a show?
No. It's been... I mean, I've been doing this for such a long time that mm-hmm. it's like walking. Yeah. And I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't do any crazy stuff. So it's always there. It's always rusty. It's always there.
Nice.
Whatever I do, it's always there. So I don't do anything special. Even though I honestly, when we have like a lot of shows, I always have like my tea, my lemon, my honey. But that's just standard. I don't
right.
do anything crazy. Yeah.
Right. Is house music still making an impact today in the world?
Of course. Yes. People miss to go out and party.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing that everybody's missing. There is a company that I'm also working with in Germany called the World Club Dome. Maybe you can Google that. It's also amazing. I did a lot of stuff for them in the past.
Nice.
And, yeah, of course, now that's completely dead. But I did a lot of stuff with them. The World Club Dome.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, they are, when the pandemic is done, they're the biggest, one of the biggest next to the Tomorrowland. They're one of the biggest concerts in the world. Yeah.
That's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's a lot happening over there.
I feel like in Europe, absolutely. Like it's way more prevalent than it is here in North America. So. I hope to one day go and experience one of those shows.
Yeah. I mean, this is all these big productions with a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
Huge. Yeah.
What album track did you record that you wish would have been a single?
I did one track with Manuela. I think it's called Are You Ready or something like that. I'm going to send you a link of that. Of one or two of those songs. I don't have it right straight up in my head right now.
Ooh, oh, oh, yeah. Ooh, oh, oh, yeah. jumping, four going up, down, taking it off town. Give it away, don't play today. I say shake or break and make no mistake. It aches, but you can take it up, down, and around and rewind. Come again, one more for the mind.
Summertime, I'll make him hot. They're giving me the feeling I can't describe. Now pump up that body, baby, make my mind go crazy. Felt the love that I have inside. I know for a fact that it's do or die. Now you gotta be hard, not soft, and give me the summer love.
One or two songs that I was like, I wish we, that was a single, because actually we only had like three singles.
Mm-hmm.
Everything else was basically or a flop because it wasn't as strong as the rest, or we had huge discussions internally, because at the end we were allowed to like have a say-so about which songs are coming out.
Yeah.
And then we had discussions with the record company, and then the record company didn't like our choices. And at the end of the day, it just didn't happen.
But those songs hit big. Like, they're still popular today. Like, I'll even go to, like, let's see, karaoke is very popular here. And Pump Up the Jam gets done to this
all
day constantly. These songs left behind a huge legacy. So it's very cool.
Yeah, all over the world. I can't believe it. Yesterday, I spoke with our agent. We were talking about... because together with Captain Hollywood, I organized like this 90s hip hop event.
Mm.
And there was one that's called Hip Hop Garden, you know?
Yeah.
And we have Rocky MC coming over there.
Oh, cool.
So we all have the same management, you know, booking agent.
Yeah.
So I was talking to our agent and I said to her, oh my God, I wish that we could make like a huge album with all these artists all together, you know, but all with new songs, you know?
Yes.
And then he said, nobody would buy it. They only want to hear old shit from you guys. I was like, okay, sorry.
Oh, man. Those, yeah, no, I get it. And like, but you still want to do new things, and that shouldn't, you should. You should just do new things anyways.
Yeah, these days, because of Instagram and, you know, all that stuff, you can do whatever you want. I love this time of today, you know? Like, then you have to ask.
Yep.
You know? Now, you just load it up on your own platform and bang, your people can hear it.
Yeah.
You know? It's good.
And that's the thing. Your fans will embrace the new music, too.
Excuse me?
Your fans will love the new music, too, as much as the old, you know?
Yeah. Of course, they love you, so they will love your new music. They'll love your new thoughts. They want to know what's happening with you. So,
yeah,
absolutely.
I'm glad you've been able to share everything that's been going on with you in the last few years. And is there anything else you want to share with our audience about what you have coming up?
Nope, everything is fine. I want everybody to stay, you know, healthy and stay cool. Don't let this pandemic get your head. It's not that serious.
Mm-hmm.
Just try to be positive in your life and, you know, talk about it when you don't feel very good to a family member or whatever. Just, you know, keep on shining. The sun is out there. It's just not everybody can see it yet. It's coming.
You're
right. It'll be fine.
Daisy, I love your attitude. It's been really positive and really inspiring. So thank you for that.
So welcome. So welcome. Thank you for thinking about me. And yeah.
I'm
the best in Canada, and I hope I will come there anytime soon again.
I'll be there. I'll come see you.
Oh, lovely. I'll see who you are. I'll see you immediately.
Excellent. I'm going to wrap things up with one last question for you.
Sure.
What food or clothing item, fashion, toy, anything makes you nostalgic for the 90s?
What makes me nostalgic for the 90s?
Yeah.
Hamburger.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's awesome.
Hamburger.
You know,
I remember I can eat hamburgers without thinking about the calories back then.
Good answer. I understand completely.
Yeah. Great.
That's how I feel about like things like pizza and stuff back then for me.
That would be so great, Naomi, to eat a hamburger and not think about anything. Not think about the guilt you feel after eating that hamburger. Oh, my God.
And back then, oh, on the road, you eat fries, hamburgers, drink Coca-Cola. Nobody cares. Because you're young, fresh, you know, you don't get no body fat.
That's right.
Nowadays, you're like, oh, my God, how many kilos extra am I going to get if I eat this burger? Let me get this out, that out, that out. Let me just eat the meat with lettuce. That's it.
Just throw away the bun. It's good.
Yes, definitely. Oh. Yeah, that's it.
It up while your feet are stumping and the jam is pumping. Look ahead, the crowd is jumping. Pump it up a little more, get the party going on the dance floor. See, cause that's where the party's at, and you find out if you do that.
And now, this is Fucking Stupid with Naomi, Kendra, Charity, Mike, and Colin.
This is Fucking Stupid is Fucking Stupid. It's a stupid game we play where you have to guess the hot song of the 90s or a super obscure song of the 90s. Our friends have no idea what I'm going to throw at them. Why don't you come play along with us?
You Wanted More, Jim Blossoms.
You got the song title, You Wanted More. That artist is incorrect.
The problem with this era of soft rock band,
they all sound the same.
So you wanted more than I could give.
I don't think this is right, but Wet Sprocket.
Oh, good name though. I gotta put that on the podcast list.
The camel on the show. I've been talking to a guy from Soul Asylum, not the singer, but the old guitar player, Dan Murphy.
I love Soul Asylum.
Okay, moving on.
This is another case of the second single.
What was the artist on the last one?
Oh, it fucked up. It's the beer. It was Tonic.
Ah.
Okay, yeah.
This is mid-90s.
Do you remember once upon a
time? Oh, fuck.
Their first single's massive.
The way it is.
Nope.
Just the way it is.
Nope.
Just the way it is, baby?
Yes, 5 points. Artist? It's that tricky. It's just the way it is, baby. You might know them by... Okay, I can't give you points after I play this. Okay? This is the other band. The song's the other song.
Oh, Rembrandt.
Rembrandt.
Yeah.
That's just too fucking easy.
Yeah.
Yep.
I didn't even let you do the clap.
That's okay. I already had the clap.
Oh, Philosopher Kings.
5 points.
Hurts to Love You.
You got it. 10 points. Philosopher Kings.
Ooh, good job on that.
I had to like hum it in my head really fast. I'm like,
that's really, and it's really hard to hum it in your head when you're trying to get, like, get ahead of the music that's playing, right?
I literally was like going like, I was literally like, it's so loud.
Sheriff, I need you now.
Here I am.
Wrong on the boat.
Need you now.
Nope.
More than words can say. Alias.
It's more than words can say. Alias. Definitely. You know, it's funny because weren't they, didn't they used to be called
sheriff?
Sheriff
before they were alias, yeah. At
6 o'clock in the morning. Fucking.
And their big hit is as Sheriff sounds exactly the same as
that's a. Isn't that baby?
Yeah. That in mind,
soon too late for love. Sorry, I'm just making an edit.
And get a real job.
Nope.
Get a haircut and get a real job.
Nope.
Nope. That's really? Not this song.
Oh, damn it. I'm just trying to get to the chorus. That's all I'm trying to do. But I can kill it if you want me to.
I love you, period.
It's I love you, period. 5 points. Artist.
I do remember this song.
I know. I've been trying to figure out the artist. I want to hold you in parentheses. It's not Ugly Kid Joe, right?
No.
No. I'll tell you this, though. They were, this is this week's podcast episode is about this guy. Dan Baird.
I just listened to that one. Like, that's not right.
Dan Baird. I love you.
Okay.
I gave you the point for I love you, period, right? Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, don't worry. I'm getting near the end of this. I promise. You can call it anytime you want.
Oh, good.
I'm good.
It's fun.
Okay. That's good. I want to hear the fun.
Play this record as frequently as possible. Then, as it becomes easier for you, play the record once a day or as needed.
Anyone hear that? Hear this before yet?
Oh, feels good.
Feels good.
Bross?
No.
Oh no, it's the guys that did the Walk the Dinosaur thing. Tony Tone Tone?
It's Tony.
Hey, Tony Tony.
Yeah.
Tony Tone.
But I'll give you all the points because it's Tony Tone Tone, I think. Okay.
Where is Ollie on that shit? This is Alanis.
It's Alanis, 5 points.
Shake your love.
What, Colin?
Is it Shake Your Love?
No.
It's
Feel Your Love?
It's Feel Your Love. 10 points. First Alanis album.
Something About Your Love.
I fucking love this song. I'd like to give it to you. She came into, when she put out the second pop album, she came into Power 92 and I got to meet her then. But like, she, you could tell like she wasn't mentally invested in this music at all. Like she was, you could tell it was not her thing.
Do you used to work at Power 92?
No.
I did.
Nope. He did, yeah.
Yeah.
But not in those days. That was like, you would have been about 14, what? Something like that?
13. Yeah. We did that homeroom countdown show for a few episodes that they had on Sunday mornings at 8 a.m.
No, I didn't live in Edmonton then.
They got kids to come in and host the show.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And then they would be like, you make your own top five countdown with you and your friends. Nice. And my countdowns were so fucking weird that they were like, what the fuck is wrong with you? Okay.
Oh, Lord.
Ready?
Jackson 5.
Don't stop. Never give up. S Club.
Wait. What did you say?
S Club 7?
5 points?
Never give up?
Is that what it's called? No one's got a title?
You only have me.
No.
Bring it all back to you.
Bring it all back to you. Nope, not quite.
Bring it all back.
Big, huge thank you to Daisy D for spending some time with us this week. Next week, my guest Sebastian is a very young man who knows a lot about 80s and 90s music, especially dance, pop, and I don't even think he was alive yet when all this music was coming out, but he is so knowledgeable on it, and he is my special guest for a show we're doing about a very special singer's career. Her name was Anna, and she's still around with us today, but she hasn't been making music for a while. We're going to catch up on everything Anna from the 90s, and you guys, see you later. Bye.
Kids, put down that Tamagotchi and listen for a second. You know, you can follow us on Twitter at NostalgiaDope, Instagram at Dope_Nostalgia. Visit our website at www.DopeNostalgia.com or pick up the phone and call us at 780-851-8785.
This podcast is licensed by SoCan because we believe that artists should be paid for their work.